Episode 13B, Trap as Trap Can. First of all, what kind of stupid title is that? Is it supposed to be a pun? Okay, moving on. So the heffalumps from There's No Camp Like Home are back, and I'm not going to complain anymore about how nobody's scared of heffalumps. That's just how heffalumps are in New Adventures, I guess, so that's fine. So Papa Heffalump is teaching his son the three T's, which are tracking, trapping, and trashing. Actually, Papa Hef says that the first T is trapping, but that doesn't make any sense. You'd have to track something before you trapped it, right? I guess he's just an idiot. But yeah, I guess going by Papa Hef, what heffalumps do is track, trap, and then trash, quote, furry woodland creatures, which we later see includes Pooh, Piglet, and Rabbit. So I guess the heffalumps are out to, trash our protagonists. I don't know what that means. But it sounds like maybe they ought to be scared of heffalumps after all. Anyway, there's a stupid comedy of errors where our heroes think that by the three T's, the young heffalump wants to learn about tea, like the drink, so they take him to Rabbit's for a tea party. Papa Hef thinks he's been kidnapped and steals him back. The gang think Papa's a ghost and steal him back. Gopher thinks the heffalump needs to learn about TNT, and Gopher apparently loves destruction. They blow up Papa Hef, but he's fine. And in the end, Pooh and Piglet let the young heffalump pretend he's tracked and caught them so his dad will think he's not a failure. Seeing that his son has mastered the possibly first T, he tells the boy to do the second and trap them, which he immediately betrays his friends and does, condemning them to be presumably trashed. Luckily, the trap misses and he traps Papa Hef instead, but Papa Hef is satisfied with this at last, even though this exact same thing happened at like the very beginning of the episode. So Baby Hef rides his penny farthing off into the sunset and it's happy endings all around. This episode's dumb and I don't like it. Episode 14A, The Masked Offender. This one's a pretty by-the-numbers, what-if-X character tried to be a superhero story. Tigger likes the stories about a Robin Hood-esque dude called the Masked Avenger, mishears the name, and decides to take up his mantle as the Masked Offender. But uh-oh, Tigger's overzealous in his quest for heroics and messes stuff up. He beats up Rabbit's Scarecrow, which leads to his garden being devoured by crows. He fills in one of Gopher's holes, which seems like a pretty minor problem. Gopher can dig through this much dirt in like half a second, but he's still mad about it on principle, I guess. And he cuts down Owl's treehouse. So the other animals, unaware that the offender is Tigger, set a trap for him by making this fake monster out of glue and molasses, which he gets stuck in, and they laugh at him. Oh, how they laugh. Anyway, Tigger's sad and retires from being a hero. But then the other animals get stuck in the monster and end up dangling off this cliff. A lot of dangling off cliffs in this show. So Tigger puts on the costume one more time and rushes out to save them, but he fails. But it's okay, everyone's fine. So in the end, Tigger's setting about fixing all the stuff he messed up, and says he'll quit being a hero for now, but maybe not forever. And then we get this ending shot, which is pretty funny. Rewatching this episode, I remember that as a kid, I was actually kind of unsettled by some of the imagery in this episode. Not like scared exactly, just kind of creeped out. Like, the monster they build is really gross. The way it just kind of settles and oozes, and that weird blank stare. But actually, the things that gives me the creeps the most in this episode is this scene, when the crows descend and instantly turn not only the garden but the surrounding landscape into a desolate wasteland. Like, look at this scenery. How bleak can you get? And the way the crows all swarm in the blink of an eye, like a swarm of beetles or something, or piranhas picking a cow skeleton clean of flesh in an instant. I don't know, to be honest, it still gives me just a hint of the old howling phantods just seeing it today. Overall, this episode's not that great. Tigger's arc in this one's really predictable, and nobody really learns anything. The bit where Tigger is humiliated is sad for a moment, but it's completely reversed by the end, so it means nothing. Episode 14B, Things That Go Piglet in the Night. Yeah, so continuing the trend of really uninteresting by-the-numbers plots again, we got another comedy of errors here, only this time everyone thinks there's a ghost. First, everyone hears Eeyore at night and thinks it's a ghost, so Piglet puts his pillowcase over his head and runs to Pooh's house for help, and everyone thinks he's a ghost. Whatever, I don't have anything to say about this part of the story. I guess I can say something about Eeyore. The reason he's bellowing at night is because he's practicing swinging on this swing and failing. This is the same swing we saw in Gone with the Wind, by the way, the one that's visible from Piglet's house. If Piglet hadn't put his pillowcase over him, I wonder if he'd have just seen Eeyore swinging and none of these shenanigans would have had to happen. But the reason Eeyore's swinging is weird, it's clear that he's practicing at night because he isn't able to do it without losing his grip and going flying off. But during the day, he says that he doesn't get to swing because the others won't give him a turn. He says this while all the rest of them are piled onto the swing at once. Honestly, I think Eeyore is just being a little Even when Tigger comes to help him, Eeyore's all woe is me, like Tigger's putting him through an ordeal. But like, Eeyore, buddy, you were here doing this of your own accord. And if you're getting sent flying when Tigger's helping you, well, that's no different from what was happening before. I get being a pessimist is like, your shtick, but shut up, you're annoying. Anyway, Eeyore fails to swing on the swing, but ends up swinging from his parachute straps after his final attempt, so happy ending, I guess. Even though Eeyore doesn't think so. Again, no one learns anything, and nothing matters. Yeah, this is turning out to be a pretty weak batch so far. Episode 15A, Luckamuck. Man, everyone's a jerk in this episode. So Tigger breaks Rabbit's mirror, and Rabbit gives Tigger the bad news that breaking a mirror means he'll have 7 years bad luck. But Tigger says that since it was Rabbit's mirror, it's Rabbit that'll have the bad luck. Tigger delivers this radical reinterpretation almost gleefully, as though he sees it as Rabbit attacking him with bad luck and him successfully parrying the blow and counterattacking. It's kind of sadistic. So Tigger tries a bunch of poorly thought out strategies to protect Rabbit from bad luck, all of which turn out to have disastrous consequences for Rabbit, seemingly confirming the bad luck hypothesis. This continues until Rabbit remembers that actually he borrowed the mirror from Pooh, meaning it's actually Pooh who's cursed with 7 years bad luck. Rabbit's a little better than Tigger, at least. He's clearly happy that Pooh's got the curse instead of him, but at least he makes a little show of being sorry for Pooh's loss. Okay, so try to wrap your brain around this next bit. Tigger's strategy for protecting Pooh from bad luck is to have him switch outfits with Piglet so the bad luck will be tricked and go for Piglet instead. I guess Tigger just thinks Piglet's expendable. Pooh doesn't even have a problem with this. He's totally fine with just passing his devastating curse on to Piglet. Even though we'll see in a minute that Tigger's plan is to seal Piglet away in a makeshift anti-bad luck fortress for 7 years. Pooh's just like, yeah man, lock that up. But by this point, Pooh and Piglet are back to wearing their own clothes, so there's no reason why the toys would think Piglet's the one that needs sealing up instead of Pooh. But Tigger seems confident that it's Piglet that's cursed now, so everyone just goes with it. So the anti-bad luck fortress fails, and Rabbit finally puts it together, sort of. I mean, if he were really on the ball, he'd figure out that Tigger's just a reckless buffoon who's been causing all the accidents. But he only gets halfway there, realizing that Tigger's been there for all the bad luck, and concludes that he was right after all, and Tigger's the cursed one since he broke the mirror. Tigger finally agrees that, yeah, he's probably the cursed one, and decides that his only choice is to go live in the wilderness until the 7 years of bad luck are over. But hooray, the other toys follow him out here and tell him that they've fixed the mirror, so the curse is lifted. And this moment right here is pretty adorable. I wonder what the logic was behind this solution that they came up with. I think to come up with it, you'd have to grasp that Tigger was causing the quote-unquote bad luck in a self-fulfilling prophecy sort of way, which Rabbit clearly didn't grasp. Pooh tells Christopher Robin at the end that he doesn't believe in superstitions and he was just playing along, so I wonder if this was Pooh's idea to basically trick Tigger into believing the bad luck was gone? That seems pretty high level for Pooh, though. And also, it's not entirely clear how genuine Pooh was being when he said he didn't believe it, since he says this as he's searching for a four-leaf clover, just in case. On the one hand, the mirror clearly isn't actually fixed, but on the other, maybe I'm overestimating the toys here. I think if I had to guess what happened, Pooh really does think that as long as the mirror shows the person that's looking at it, it's performing its function and is therefore fixed. It's kind of Aristotelian. Like, to Pooh, the essence of the mirror is to show the person that looks into it. A broken mirror doesn't do that, and therefore lacks its essential mirrorness. But make the mirror show the person looking at it, even by cheating like this, and you restore its mirrorly essence. So I can't talk about this episode without mentioning that this one, even more so than Masked Defender, actually really spooked me as a kid. The tone is honestly pretty dark, largely thanks to Rabbit, who spends a lot of the episode in extreme emotional distress. But in particular, there's two scenes I want to mention. First, this one where Rabbit takes a bath and ends up getting sucked down the drain. Like, really look at this and tell me with a straight face that you don't think this would terrify a little kid. It doesn't even make sense. Rabbit must shrink to like 2 inches wide for this to be possible, and yet, here we are. It's like watching a nightmare. Second, and this one's the one that really stuck with me, is this scene, right after lightning strikes Piglet's anti-bad luck fortress. There's this shot of the toys carrying Piglet's bed in a way that I can't help but think resembles pallbearers carrying a casket, and then there's this long shot of Piglet's twisted catatonic face staring directly into the camera. I think it's supposed to be silly, but, I'm not laughing. And look at this. Are you comfortable right now? Is this fun? Are you enjoying your lighthearted baby cartoon? This shot creeped me the fuck out as a kid, and I remember having to look away from the screen whenever I saw it. Piglet even stays in this catatonic state for almost the rest of the episode. It's really creepy. Okay, so I think you get the point. This one really left an impression on me. Overall, I think this episode's a mixed bag. Mostly, it's just not very fun. Also, the animation seems pretty off at times, like the characters' faces seem off-model in some shots, and their eyes all seem a little, I don't know, like, bigger and blanker than usual. On the other hand, this episode actually does have a point and says something about superstitions and self-fulfilling prophecies. The characters never really grasp it, but the message is clear as day to the audience, even little kids. So, I give it props for that. Word up. Episode 15B, The Magic Earmuffs. Okay, so I had a bunch to say about that last one, but don't worry, this one's dumb again. It's winter and everyone's playing ice hockey, or ice cookie, since they're using a cookie as the puck, teehee. But Piglet's all distraught because he can't skate. So the others offer to teach him, but Piglet doesn't think he can do it. So Christopher Robin gives Piglet his earmuffs and tells him they're magic and will make him able to skate. So now Piglet's got the confidence to actually try, and he figures it out. But then, oh, the humanity. The ice breaks, and then these guys go out on the ice without their skates, and they get swept away on ice chunks toward this deadly waterfall. It's pretty ridiculous to think that the ice could break this thoroughly and this suddenly, that the ice would be completely frozen over one moment, and the next melted to such a degree that they're being swept down river like this, but whatever. I'm more annoyed by how it's starting to feel like characters facing deadly falls off cliffs is kind of just the show's go-to climax. Alright, let's see here. So it happened in Finder Keeper, it happened in Gone with the Wind, and it happened in The Masked Defender, and now this episode. So unless I'm forgetting any more, this is the fourth time that characters facing a deadly fall off a cliff has happened in 22 episodes, meaning it's happened in just over 18%. Of every story that New Adventures has told so far. I guess that's not completely egregious, but it's still a lot. And I mean, Masked Defender was only 3 episodes ago, so maybe that's why I'm feeling like I've seen enough of this already. So, bafflingly, Piglet's plan to save the others from the waterfall is just to throw them their skates, even though they're on ice chunks that aren't connected to land. But it works, I guess. I guess they just needed to be able to stand up so they could wait till they just happened to float near the river's edge and hop onto dry land. Very impressive. Anyway, Piglet skates out, onto the river, over these free-flowing ice chunks, just to toss Pooh his skates so he too can perform this incredible feat. But Piglet loses his earmuffs, so instead of just doing the impossible like the others did and just skating off that free-flowing river, he skates downriver towards the waterfall after the earmuffs. You know, because he can't skate without them. Yeah, Pooh points this out. Yeah, the point is that Piglet could skate even without the earmuffs. I get it. I still hate it. This scenario is so insanely treacherous, and Piglet's performing such titanic feats of athleticism that the episode just completely lost me, and I'm just rolling my eyes. This is nothing short of superhuman. Maybe Legolas could pull this off on a really good day. But this is Piglet we're talking about. Piglet, who put skates on for the first time mere hours ago. So he figures out he doesn't need the earmuffs, but he goes over the waterfall anyway, but it's fine, whatever, he just, like, skates up the edge or something. Danger, imaginary. Who cares? The end.
Oh, God. Well, I don't know if you couldn't tell,
but really didn't enjoy these. Found very little joy in this set of episodes. They were, none of them had anything going for them really, except maybe Luckamuck. And I didn't even like that one, to be honest. It's it feels bad, man. But I watched them, and I'm going to keep watching them. Not thinking about quitting or anything. But, I don't know. But if it stays, you know, if I had a bunch of batches back to back that were all like this, then I might start to think, maybe I should stop this. But, you know, they've been good. They've been good up till now. I'm sure they'll get better again. I'm sure it'll get better again. I'm sure things can only get better from here. This is what's known in literature as the hero's lowest point. All right, whatever. Thanks for listening. As always, thank you to these names. Pledging $5 or more on Patreon. And an extra special thank you to Matthew, David, Ash, Bub Bob, Chelsea, and Crack, all of whom are pledging $25 or more on Patreon. Thanks, everybody. Thanks for helping me out as I do this. you know, it's all worth it. Even when the episodes are bad and miserable, it's still worth it. Thank you, and good night.